So today I thought we will go into something about how to properly glorify a Vaishnava. Firstly, we should understand that glorification of a Vaishnava or glorification of Krishna, the spiritual master, Lord Chaitanya, is different from offering respect. So when we begin devotional service, the first thing we should learn is how to offer respect. How to offer respect to the Supreme Lord, how to offer respect to the spiritual master, how to offer respect to the Vaishnavas at different levels. So that is part of Vaishnava etiquette. And we should also hear from the proper sources the glorification of Krishna. Just like Krishna is glorified by Arjuna in the Bhagavad Gita. Krishna is glorified by so many devotees in the Srimad Bhagavatam. So we should hear those glories, sufficiently hear the glories. One specific point regarding glorification is that all such great devotees glorify Krishna, or even Krishna glorifies his devotees. Lord Chaitanya glorifies his devotees. And devotees also glorify Krishna. Devotees glorify Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So the glorification is always on the spiritual platform. Glorification is not done about any material qualities. It's always about spiritual qualities, transcendental attributes. And secondly, glorification is always about something factual. It is not something imagined. It's not something that is speculated. So there is no room for speculation. There is no room for any kind of imagination. No. It is factual statement of the real attributes, the real qualities of the Supreme Lord, of the spiritual master, of the Vaishnavas. Secondly, when somebody glorifies, then they are having the proper adhikara. Unless that adhikara is there, the glorification will not be appropriate. Just like disciples glorify their spiritual master on specifically on the day of Vyas Puja. Otherwise also, disciples do glorify their spiritual master on every day, on a daily basis, always. So this glorification, first of all, we begin by repeating the glorification of the Supreme Lord or of the spiritual master as taught to us by the standard devotional authorities. Just like every day we worship Srila Prabhupada, we sing his glories as taught to us by Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur, as taught to us by Srila Narottam Das Thakur. The Samsara Dava prayers we offer to the spiritual master are taught to us by Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur. Narottam Das Thakur has taught us the prayers we offer during Guru Puja to Srila Prabhupada. So we repeat the glories of the Supreme Lord, of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, of the Vaishnavas, great Vaishnava Acharyas, as it is described by great authorities, spiritual authorities, devotional authorities. So that way we get a proper understanding. What does this glorification involve? How they are glorifying? Now you can see behind the glorification, if you carefully study the scriptures, that there is a consistent and coherent philosophy of Krishna consciousness, which is definitely present in the glorification. That is how Srila Prabhupada writes purports in the Srimad Bhagavatam when Kunti Devi offers prayers to Krishna. Srila Prabhupada writes very elaborate purports. Now in those purports, the philosophy of Krishna consciousness is very much present. Just when Kunti Devi glorifies Krishna, the glorification is factual. Therefore, there is so much of philosophy of Krishna consciousness in that. That these are all facts about the Supreme Lord. Of course, we should always remember that the Supreme Lord, Krishna, is unlimited, so his glories are unlimited. There are many, many glories of the Supreme Lord. We cannot reach the end of the glorification. Just like Ananta Sesha, with countless mouths, is constantly glorifying the Supreme Lord since the beginning of creation. And he is not being able to reach. He is not able to reach the end of the glories of Krishna. So, which means that Krishna's glories are unlimited. Therefore, we should hear about these glories and we should actually become properly educated. The facts about Krishna's greatness, Krishna's opulence, Krishna's kindness, Krishna's wonderful qualities, and Krishna's pastimes, Krishna's names, Krishna's forms, everything about Krishna. Then we actually glorify Krishna by repeating the glories we have heard from proper sources, standard sources. We recite those glories in the form of verses or in the form of even descriptions. When we preach or when we discuss with somebody or when we describe to somebody about Krishna consciousness, when we share something about Krishna consciousness with others who do not know. So that way we actually, in the beginning, we don't independently compose our own prayers of glorification, or we don't compose independently in the beginning. Slowly, as we actually become well-versed with the facts about Krishna's glories, facts about the pure devotees' glories, facts about great Vaishnavas' glories, we are able to get a proper understanding, and then we are able to actually ourselves offer prayers of glorification. So, we have examples. I have now gathered something about Chaitanya Mahaprabhu glorifying his devotees. Now, why have I specifically selected this to give an example is because it is said about Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, Apani Achari Prabhu Jivera Shikshaya. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he appeared as a pure devotee of Krishna, even though he is Krishna himself. What is the reason? It is for the sake of educating everyone about devotional service by personally performing devotional service. So, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu has himself performed devotional service, even though he is the Lord. But he has done devotional service. So, part of his performing devotional service is glorifying his devotees, glorifying the devotees. So he's, let's hear something about Chaitanya Mahaprabhu glorifying his devotee. This is from Chaitanya Charitamrita, Madhya Leela. There are many places where Chaitanya Mahaprabhu has glorified his devotee, but I've selected some two different sections. This is from Madhya Leela 15th chapter in the Chaitanya Charitamrita. After the Rathyatra was over one time, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was bidding farewell to the devotees who had come from Bengal. And he then informed everyone, it is said here, just hear about the pure devotional service rendered to Krishna by Raghava Pandit. Raghava Pandit is one great devotee of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Now, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is glorifying Raghava Pandit's pure devotional service to Krishna. Indeed, Raghava Pandit's service is supremely pure and highly accomplished. Apart from other commodities, just hear about his offering of coconuts. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is describing how Raghava Pandit makes an offering of coconuts to the deity of Krishna. A coconut is sold at the rate of 5 gandas each. Although Raghava Pandit has hundreds of trees and millions of fruits, he still is very eager to hear about the place where sweet coconuts are available. He collects coconuts with great endeavor from a place 20 miles away and he pays 4 panas each for them. That means he pays much, much more than what is the normal rate for a coconut. If he comes to know that there are somebody, some place, even several miles away, somebody selling sweet coconuts, to offer them to the Lord. Every day, 5 to 7 coconuts are clipped and put into water to keep cool. At the time of offering bhoga, the coconuts are again clipped and cleansed. After holes are made in them at the top, they are offered to Krishna. Lord Krishna drinks the juice from these coconuts, and sometimes the coconuts are left drained of juice. At other times, the coconuts remain filled with juice. When Raghava Pandit sees that the juice has been drunk from the coconuts, he is very pleased. He then breaks the coconuts, takes out the pulp, and puts it on another plate. After offering the pulp, he meditates outside the temple door. In the meantime, Lord Krishna, having eaten the pulp, leaves the plate empty. Sometimes, after eating the pulp, Krishna fills the plate again with new pulp. In this way, the faith of Raghava Pandit increases and he floats in an ocean of love. Raghava Pandit's devotional service is so very pleasing to the Lord that the Lord actually empties the coconut empties the plate. He prepares, of course, there is a very elaborate description. I have shortened it. I am selecting some just important points here. He prepares cakes, sweet rice, condensed milk and everything else with great attention. And the cooking conditions are purified so that the food is first class and delicious. Raghava Pandit also offers all kinds of pickles. He offers various scents, garments, ornaments and the best of everything. Thus, Raghava Pandit serves the Lord in an incomparable way. Everyone is very much satisfied just to see him. So that is Raghava Pandit's devotional service that Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is glorifying. Next, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu became very happy just to speak the glories of his devotees. Indeed, when he spoke of their glories, it was as if he had 5 faces. Means he was full of glories for his devotees. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu then informed all his devotees, please hear about Mukunda's love of Godhead. It is a very deep and pure love and can only be compared with purified gold. Mukunda Dasa externally appears to be a royal physician engaged in governmental service, but internally he has a deep love for Krishna. Who can understand his love? One day, Mukunda Dasa, the royal physician, was seated with a Muslim king on a high platform and was telling the king about medical treatment. While the king and Mukundadasa were conversing, a servant brought a fan made of peacock feathers to shade the king's head from the sun. Consequently, he held the fan above the king's head. Just by seeing the peacock feathered fan, Mukundadasa became absorbed in ecstatic love of Godhead and fell from the high platform onto the ground. The king, fearing that the royal physician had been killed, personally descended and brought him to consciousness. When the king asked Mukunda, "Where is it paining you?" Mukunda replied, "I am not very much pained." The king then inquired, "Mukunda, why did you fall down?" Mukunda replied, "My dear king, I have a disease like epilepsy." Being extraordinarily intelligent, the king could understand the whole affair. In his estimation, Mukunda was a most uncommon, exalted, liberated personality. That means it is due to his devotion for Krishna that he exhibited some ecstatic symptoms that even the king could understand. Then Chaitanya Mahaprabhu speaks about Murari Gupta. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu then embraced Murari Gupta and began to speak about his firm faith and devotional service. This was heard by all the devotees. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said, "Previously I induced Murari Gupta again and again to be allured by Lord Krishna. I said to him, 'My dear Gupta, Lord Sri Krishna, Virjendra Kumara, is the supreme sweetness.' I then requested Murari Gupta, 'Worship Krishna and take shelter of him, but for his service, nothing appeals to the mind.' Murari Gupta then replied, 'I am your servant and your order carrier. I have no independent existence.'" Actually, Murari Gupta was a worshipper of Lord Ramachandra. He was a devotee of Lord Rama. So, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu tried to induce him to worship Krishna instead of worshipping Rama. So, after this, Murari Gupta went home and spent the whole night thinking how he would have to give up the association of Raghunath, Lord Ramachandra. Thus, he was overwhelmed. Murari Gupta then began to pray to the lotus feet of Lord Ramachandra. He prayed that death would come that night, because it was not possible for him to give up the service of the lotus feet of Raghunath. Thus Murari Gupta cried the entire night. There was no rest for his mind. Therefore he could not sleep but stayed awake the entire night. In the morning Murari Gupta came to see me. See me means Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is describing. Murari Gupta went to see Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Catching hold of my feet and crying, he submitted an appeal. Murari Gupta said, "I sold my head unto the lotus feet of Raghunatha, Lord Ramachandra. I cannot withdraw my head, for that would give me too much pain. It is not possible for me to give up the service of Raghunatha's lotus feet. At the same time, if I do not do so, I shall break your order. What can I do?" In this way, Murari Gupta appealed to me saying, "You are all merciful, so kindly grant me this mercy. Let me die before you so that all my doubts will be finished." Hearing this, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is telling, hearing this, I became very happy. I then raised Murari Gupta and embraced him. I said to him, "All glories to you, Murari Gupta. Your method of worship is very firmly fixed, so much so that even upon my request, your mind did not turn. The servitor must have love and affection for the lotus feet of the Lord exactly like this. Even if the Lord wants separation, a devotee cannot abandon the shelter of his lotus feet. Just to test your firm faith in your Lord, I requested you again and again to change your worship from Lord Ramachandra to Krishna." Then Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is telling, "In this way I congratulated Murari Gupta saying, 'Indeed you are the incarnation of Hanuman. Consequently you are the eternal servant of Lord Ramachandra. Why should you give up the worship of Lord Ramachandra and his lotus feet? Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu continued, I accept this Murari Gupta as my life and soul. When I hear of his humility, it perturbs my very life. So this is another quality of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's devotees. They are all very, 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 very humble. It is not possible to properly glorify either the Supreme Lord or a Vaishnava or the spiritual master if we are not properly situated in Vaishnava humility. This is very evident. If one has a very high estimation of oneself, or one thinks, I am a great devotee, then it is not possible to properly glorify the real devotees or the great devotees, the other devotees, or even the Supreme Lord for that matter. It's not possible. Now I will give you another example of a devotee, Vallabha Bhatta. He was a very learned scholar, and he was thinking that he can very nicely explain the philosophy of Krishna consciousness. He was proud of his learning. So when Chaitanya Mahaprabhu detected this, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu wanted to help Vallabha Bhatta cut down his pride. So in order to do so, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, on one occasion when Vallabha Bhatta had come to meet Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu began to speak to Vallabha Bhatta. My dear Vallabha Bhatta, you are a learned scholar. Kindly listen to me. I am a sannyasi of the Mayavada school. Therefore, I have no chance of knowing what Krishna Bhakti is. Now, this reply by Chaitanya Mahaprabhu to Vallabha Bhatta is after Vallabha Bhatta had come to meet Chaitanya Mahaprabhu to show Chaitanya Mahaprabhu some commentary Vallabha Bhatta had written on the Srimad Bhagavatam. Now, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu wanted to point out to Vallabha Bhatta that one cannot properly write a commentary on the Bhagavatam or even glorify Krishna if one is having pride in his heart. So in order to point that out, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu himself, what is he telling? When Vallabha Bhatta glorified Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, you are a great devotee. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said, I don't know what is Krishna Bhakti because I am a sannyasi of the Mayavada school. Why is Chaitanya Mahaprabhu telling this? Because he took sannyas from one Mayavadi sannyasi, Keshava Bharati. So based on that, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is telling this. He continues to speak to Vallabha Bhatta. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu says, nevertheless, my mind has become purified because I have associated with Advaita Acharya, who is directly the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Advaita Acharya is incarnation of Mahavishnu. So he is directly the Supreme Personality of God. So that is what Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is telling. Advaita Acharya is unparalleled in his understanding of all the revealed scriptures and the devotional service of Lord Krishna. Therefore, he is called Advaita Acharya. He is such a great personality. Advaita Acharya is glorifying Advaita Acharya. He is such a great personality that by his mercy he can convert even the meat eaters, mlechas, into devotional service of Krishna, who therefore can estimate his power of Vaishnavism. This is why Chaitanya Mahaprabhu glorified Advaita Acharya. Next, he glorifies Nityananda Prabhu. Lord Nityananda Prabhu, the Avadhuta, is also directly the Supreme Personality of Godhead. He is always intoxicated with the madness of ecstatic love. Indeed, he is an ocean of love of Krishna. So this is the way Chaitanya Mahaprabhu glorifies Nityananda Prabhu. Next, he glorifies Sarvam Bhattacharya. Sarvam Bhattacharya perfectly knows the six philosophical theses, the Shad Darshana. He is therefore the spiritual master of the entire world in teaching the six paths of philosophy. He is the best of devotees. Saravam Bhattacharya has shown me the limit of devotional service. Only by his mercy have I understood that devotional service to Krishna is the essence of all mystic yoga. So in this way he has glorified Saravam Bhattacharya. Next he glorifies Ramananda Raya. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu says, Srila Ramananda Raya is the ultimate knower of the transcendental mellows of Lord Krishna's devotional service. He has instructed me that Lord Krishna is the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Through the mercy of Ramananda Raya, I have understood that ecstatic love of Krishna is the highest goal of life, and that spontaneous love of Krishna is the highest perfection. Then Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is quoting from Srimad Bhagavatam, whatever was pointed out by Ramananda Raya from the Bhagavatam. This is justified, this statement that ecstatic love of Krishna is the highest goal of life and spontaneous love of Krishna is the highest perfection in bhakti. So quoting from the Srimad Bhagavatam, 10th canto, 9th chapter, 21st verse. The Supreme Personality of Godhead Krishna, the son of Mother Yashoda, is accessible to those devotees engaged in spontaneous loving service. But he is not as easily accessible to mental speculators. He is not easily accessible to those striving for self-realization by severe austerities and penances. He is not accessible to those who consider the body the same as the self. Then one more quotation from the Srimad Bhagavatam. When Lord Sri Krishna was dancing with the gopis in the Rasa Leela, the gopis were embraced around the neck by the Lord's arms. This transcendental favor was never bestowed upon the goddess of fortune or the other consorts of the spiritual world, nor was such a thing ever imagined by the most beautiful girls in the heavenly planets. Girls whose bodily luster and aroma resemble the beauty and fragrance of lotus flowers. And what to speak of worldly women who may be very, very beautiful according to material estimation. This is a verse that is quoted from Srimad Bhagavatam. Another verse from the Srimad Bhagavatam regarding the position of the cowherd boys who are playing with Krishna. Neither those who are engaged in self-realization, appreciating the Brahman effulgence of the Lord, nor those engaged in devotional service while accepting the Supreme Personality of Godhead as Master, nor those who are under the clutches of Maya, thinking the Lord an ordinary person, can understand that certain exalted personalities, after accumulating volumes of pious activities, are now playing with the Lord in friendship as covered boys. So, the position of Mother Yashoda, the position of the gopis who participate in rasa dance, and the position of the cowherd boys who are playing with Krishna. Now, the greatness of these devotees is also explained in the Bhagavatam. When Mother Yashoda saw all the universes within Krishna's mouth, she was astonished for the time being. The Lord is worshipped like Indra and other demigods by the followers of the three Vedas who offer him sacrifices. The Lord is worshipped as impersonal Brahman by saintly persons who understand his greatness through studying the Upanishads. The Lord is worshipped as the Purusha by great philosophers who analytically study the universe. The Lord is worshipped as the all-pervading super soul by great yogis. He is worshipped as the Supreme Personality of Godhead by devotees. Nevertheless, Mother Yashoda considered the Lord her own son. This is spontaneous devotional service. In spontaneous devotional service, the devotees never regard Krishna as the Supreme Lord. They always have got the greatest affection for Krishna in devotion, and that makes them actually forget about Krishna's greatness as the Supreme Personality of God. Then Chaitanya Mahaprabhu continues to speak about Ramananda Raya. Ramananda Raya is extremely aware of transcendental mellows. He is incessantly absorbed in the happiness of ecstatic love of Krishna. It is he who has taught me all this. How could Chaitanya Mahaprabhu quote all these Bhagavatam verses? Because Ramananda Raya taught him. It is impossible to describe the influence and knowledge of Ramananda Raya, for only by his mercy have I understood the unalloyed love of the residents of Vrindavana. So that much about Ramananda Raya. Next, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu glorifies Swarup Damodar. The transcendental mellows of ecstatic love are personified by Swarup Damodar. By his association, I have understood Vrindavan's transcendental mellow of conjugal love. The unalloyed love of the gopis and Srimati Radharani is without any trace of material lust. The criterion of such transcendental love is that its only purpose is to satisfy Krishna. So, one quotation from the Bhagavatam. O dearly beloved, this is Gopi speaking to Krishna, your lotus feet are so soft that we place them gently on our breasts, fearing that your feet will be hurt. Our lives rest only in you. Our minds therefore are filled with anxiety that your tender feet might be wounded by pebbles as you roam about on the forest path. Krishna used to go cow herding every day, and the gopis would begin to feel that Krishna is wandering in the forest, so his very, very tender feet might be hurt. The conjugal love of the gopis is the most exalted devotional service, surpassing all other methods of bhakti. Therefore, Lord Krishna is obliged to say, my dear gopis, I cannot repay you. Indeed, I am always indebted to you for your service. So there is a verse from the Bhagavatam that Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is quoting. O gopis, this is spoken by Krishna to the gopis. O gopis, I am not able to repay my debt for your spotless service even within a lifetime of Brahma. Your connection with me is beyond reproach. You have worshipped me, cutting off all domestic ties which are difficult to break. Therefore, please let your own glorious deeds be your compensation. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is saying, I'm unable to repay for your service. Now, further, the devotional service of Uddhava, completely distinct from love of Krishna and opulence, pure love of Krishna is on the highest level. On the surface of the world, there is no devotee greater than Uddhava. Uddhava desires to take on his head the dust of the gopis' lotus feet. I have learned about all these transcendental loving affairs of Lord Krishna from Swarup Damodar, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is telling. Another quotation from the Srimad Bhagavatam. This is Uddhava's prayer. The gopis of Vrindavan have given up the association of their husbands, sons and other family members who are very difficult to give up. And they have forsaken the path of chastity to take shelter of the lotus feet of Mukunda Krishna, which one should search for by Vedic knowledge. Oh, let me be fortunate enough to become one of the bushes, creepers or herbs in Vrindavan. For the gopis trample them and bless them with the dust of their lotus feet. This is Uddhava's prayer. He wishes to take the dust of the lotus feet of the gopis in his next birth in Vrindavan as one of the bushes, creepers or herbs in Vrindavan. Next, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu glorifies Haridas Thakur. Haridas Thakur, the teacher of the holy name, is the most exalted of all pure devotees. Every day he chants 300,000 holy names of the Lord. I have learned about the glories of the Lord's holy name from Haridas Thakur, and by his mercy I have understood these glories. Next, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu glorifies many other devotees. He mentions all of them, some of them here. Acharya Ratna, Acharya Nidhi, Gadadhar Pandit, Jagadananda, Damodara, Shankara, Vakreshwara, Kashishwara, Mukunda, Vasudeva, Murari, and many other devotees have descended in Bengal to preach to everyone the glories of the holy name of Krishna and the value of love for him. I have learned from them the meaning of devotional service to Krishna. This is what Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is telling Vallabha Bhatta. Knowing that Vallabha Bhatta's heart was full of pride, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu spoke these words, hinting at how one can learn about devotional service. Vallabha Bhatta was thinking, I am a great Vaishnava. Having learned all the conclusions of Vaishnava philosophy, I can understand the meaning of Srimad Bhagavatam and explain it very well. This was the pride of Vallabha Bhatta. So, such pride had existed for a long time within the mind of Vallabha Bhatta. But as he heard the preaching of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, his pride was cut down. So the only reason Chaitanya Mahaprabhu spoke to Vallabha Bhatta at length like this is to cut down his pride. Which means that devotional service, we cannot make progress, factual progress, unless we give up pride even in the matter of our own devotional service. In the matter of whatever devotional understanding we may have, there's no room for pride in the heart of a devotee. That's why when Krishna explains in Bhagavad Gita the 20 items of knowledge in the 13th chapter, the very first item Krishna mentions is humility, amanitvam. And immediately next, Krishna mentions adambitvam. Amanitvam is humility. Adambitvam is pridelessness. Now, Prabhupada very nicely explains the difference between humility and pride. What's the difference? Humility is when one is... Prabhupada describes humility as when one is free from the desire to receive honor or respect from others. That is humility. Whereas pridelessness is, pride itself is when one has very high estimation of oneself independent of others' opinion. Others may or may not have a high estimation of me, but I think I am great. So that is pride. Such pride is also a big detrimental obstacle for bhakti, for pure devotional service, as is lack of humility. When somebody is very eager to receive respect and honor from others, then that is lack of humility. So we have to give up this pride. We have to become completely prideless before we even begin to actually make advancement, factual advancement on the path of devotional service. Yesterday we also heard in the Bhagavatam class, Jai Chaitanya Prabhu describing that sometimes devotees are very, very anxious or eager to know, I want to know how much progress I have made in devotional service. So very nicely it was explained yesterday that you should not try to estimate your progress by yourself. Never do that. It's for the others, the other Vaishnavas, especially senior Vaishnavas, qualified Vaishnavas, to actually do that kind of assessment or estimation. That's why it's so important that we serve Krishna in the association of Vaishnavas. The Chaitanya Charitamrita, in many places it's explained, just like Vallabha Bhatta, he was very eager to associate with Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, but he was not associating with Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's devotees. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, I have not extracted that portion of the Chaitanya Charitamrita. It is described, after his pride was cut down, he told Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, I am very eager to meet all your devotees. All these devotees whose names you mentioned, Advaita Acharya, Nityananda Prabhu, I want to meet them. Then Chaitanya Mahaprabhu actually tells Vallabha Bhatta that yes, they will come for the Rath Yatra. So after the Rath Yatra, you can meet them. So then Vallabha Bhatta goes and tries to meet the devotees of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And in their association, he could further understand that even the devotees of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu are so exalted. And he was thinking he was a great devotee. Sometimes people may be executing some regulative principles very strictly, very nicely. But that alone does not make very nicely, I am doing all the following all the principles and executing my sadhana bhakti. That alone is not enough. That is required, yes. But that's not enough. You have to do it in the association of devotees. And in the association of devotees, how to specifically, this point is very important, how to respect other Vaishnavas. Unless a sense of respect within the heart is there for the other Vaishnavas with whom we are doing devotional service in the community, until then our devotional service doesn't begin to mature. Maturity in devotional service is only possible in the association of devotees who are similarly seriously engaged. So therefore, we have to execute devotional service in the association of devotees. Srila Prabhupada also says that sometimes devotees, they think if they just worship Krishna very nicely, very strictly, following all the principles from the authentic scriptures, then I can become a nice devotee. No, that is not enough. You have to approach a bona fide spiritual master and learn from the spiritual master how to actually culture this practice of sadhana bhakti, cultivate devotional service. And then also the importance is given not only to the spiritual master and Krishna, but even to the other devotees who are similarly engaged in devotional service. So again, Srila Prabhupada is stressing the association of devotees. In fact, many times he says, I have created this ISKCON society simply to give an opportunity for people to get association of devotees. So association of devotees is very, very, very important. And that is what is taught by Krishna also. Krishna also, he glorifies his devotees. When Narada Muni visited Krishna in Dwaraka, how did Krishna receive Narada Muni? Narada knows who is Krishna. Krishna knows Narada is his devotee. But still, as enacting his role as the king, the Kshatriya, how should a Kshatriya king receive a saintly person? So exactly that way Krishna received Narada and actually washed his feet, worshipped him. Yeah. So just like how Sudama Brahmana, he went to meet Krishna because Krishna is his friend from Gurukul days. Now Krishna is now the ruler of Dwaraka after finishing his Gurukul education. As the son of Vasudeva, he went to Gurukul. So there he had this Brahmana friend, Sudama. So now Sudama has come to meet Krishna in the palace, and Sudama is received by Krishna. The detailed description is given in the Bhagavatam 10th canto, that Krishna made him sit on his personal throne, Krishna washed his feet, he sprinkled the water that washed Sudama's feet on his head. Rukmini was personally fanning Sudama. So this is the standard of respect to be offered properly. In fact, in the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says that I have no duties to perform, still I am engaged. So that is in the third chapter, he says. Name parthasti kartavyam trishu lokeshu kinchana nanavaptam avaptavyam. So he says, I have nothing to gain or nothing to achieve by doing any duties, neither I have any duties, but still I am engaged. So that is because Krishna wants to teach by his personal example how one should actually perform one's prescribed duties. He's showing by his personal example. So from all this we can understand that we have to render devotional service in the association of devotees, and we have to actually learn from other devotees about devotional service in addition to studying scriptures, etc. So I will now take some questions if there are any questions. Okay, the first question, I'll read the question. Humility being an important quality which impresses and pleases Krishna very much. So how do I develop humility in adverse situation than acting out of my natural instinct? Humility is cultivated. Humility means that Prabhupada gives the definition in the 13th chapter. I'll read that out. So not being anxious to receive honor from others. That's what Prabhupada says. Humility means one should not be anxious to have the satisfaction of being honored by others. The material conception of life makes us very eager to receive honor from others. But from the point of view of a man in perfect knowledge, who knows he is not this body, anything honor or dishonor pertaining to the body is useless. One should not be hankering after this material deception. So to give up this systematically, we have to cultivate this quality. It doesn't happen overnight, definitely, for a neophyte devotee. But certainly we should give up this eagerness to actually have the to receive respect from others. Rather, we should always be looking forward to hearing glories of Krishna, hearing glories of even from others' mouth also. What would you like to hear from others' mouth? You would like to hear glories of Krishna. You would like to hear glories of pure devotees. You would like to hear the glories of the spiritual master. You would like to hear glories of previous acharyas. So in a society of devotees, this is what is cultivated. Devotees generally, they first of all glorify Krishna. Then they glorify other great authorities in devotional service, especially those devotees who are mentioned in the Srimad Bhagavatam, devotees of Lord Chaitanya, previous acharyas, and our own spiritual master. So we should first actually hear, and we should also repeat and recite, as I said. By that, automatically we will give up our own desire for hearing our glories or hearing about our respect. Okay, next question. If we glorify good qualities of other devotees, we also develop those qualities. So in our community of devotees, how do we properly glorify devotees genuinely? As I said, first of all, you have to hear the glories of Krishna, you have to hear the glories of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, you have to hear the glories of devotees in the Bhagavatam, Chaitanya Charitamrita. That is the first business. Hearing itself will purify you, actually. But as you hear and you also learn to respect devotees, before glorifying, you have to respect devotees, as I told you. Respect devotees properly, according to Vaishnava etiquette. This is nothing to do with the standing of the devotee. This is Vaishnava etiquette. So, just like we heard yesterday, Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur used to say, my disciples are my saviors. So, the mood is that we have to respect other Vaishnavas, even though they are not, they may not be very, very exalted devotees. Still, we have to learn to respect them. So, like Prabhupada taught us to call other Vaishnavas as Prabhu. Prabhu means you are my master. I am your servant. Whenever we write a letter at the end, we say, your servant. This is not just for writing or some kind of social etiquette. It is actually the feeling within the heart we should develop, that I am a servant of the Vaishnavas. So to develop this, we have to actually act like that. We have to think like that. We have to understand that. And then only we will be able to properly glorify devotees. So we have to get the adhikar. So that takes time to actually culture this bhakti. We have to culture bhakti, culture devotion sense. Next one. In the community of devotees, when someone glorifies me, how do I handle this glorification, remain humble at the same time? First of all, the person who is glorifying you doesn't know whom to glorify properly. First of all, that person, is he glorifying Krishna? He or she is glorifying Krishna? Have they learned how to glorify a spiritual master? Have they learned how to glorify great devotees from the Srimad Bhagavatam? Before that, why are they trying to glorify you? This is some kind of tendency which is carried forward from the material world. Material world, simply people interact with each other, flatter each other, or even sometimes speak about some good qualities, material qualities of others, simply so that they may also in exchange receive some glorification, or they may get some work done, or they may please somebody to get some favor. We have none of this agenda as devotees. So you should teach that devotee, you should explain to that devotee, why are you glorifying me? It's an opportunity for you to correct him, to educate him. Maybe that devotee is a real, real neophyte. He doesn't know. He has heard somewhere he should glorify Vaishnava. So he's glorifying. But he should explain what, now what I'm saying is, first of all, tell him to hear glory sufficiently. And tell him to learn to respect Vaishnavas, not glorify Vaishnavas in the beginning. Respect Vaishnavas, in whose association he is actually learning how to become a mature devotee. Okay, next question. Should we take part in glorification of material qualities also for Vaishnavas which are not connected to KC? Never. We are not concerned with material qualities. Materially, there may be even disqualification. As Rupa Goswami, Sri Rupa Goswami says in Upadeshamrita, a pure devotee's bodily defect should never be seen. You see? So, where is the question of looking at any material attributes at all? Never. What is meant by, next question, what is meant by maturity in devotional service? Maturity means your devotional service has become sufficiently cultivated, because of which you have become firmly fixed up and you are steady in executing devotional service without having any personal ambitions. This is the most important point. Devotional service in the beginning will be mixed with our own personal desires. Either knowingly or unknowingly, it is said that a neophyte devotee mixes devotional service to Krishna or devotional service to the spiritual master with his own personal ambitions. But maturity means we learn to recognize that I have some personal desires and I am mixing it with my devotional service. So, eliminate all personal ambitions and go deep inside your heart and introspect and see. Heart is full of so many material ambitions that you may not even know that you have such ambitions. So, that requires purification. So, unless one has sufficiently purified his heart, What does Bhagavatam say? Nashta prayeshu abhadreshu. Prayeshu means almost nil. When the dirt in the heart, when the contamination in the heart has become almost nil, that is when one becomes fixed up. So Srila Prabhupada is asked by one devotee, what does this mean, almost nil? So Prabhupada says, say 75% or 80% you have become purified. 80% purification. So that is what Srila Prabhupada says. 80% purification was a long time to go. So we have to wait. Next question. Once you told in class in Ahmedabad regarding Ramachandra Puri pastimes that we should not glorify or chastise anyone. So should we glorify devotees or not? See, Ramachandra Puri as a sannyasi, what was pointed out by Paramananda Puri. Now you read that pastime very carefully in the Chaitanya Charitamrita. If you read the pastime, you understand that as a sannyasi, what was the proper behavior for Ramachandra Puri? That is what Paramananda Puri, another sannyasi, god brother of Ramachandra Puri, was pointing out to Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. That Ramachandra Puri, as a sannyasi, should neither chastise anybody nor glorify anybody else as a sannyasi. So he would not glorify anybody, he would follow that part of the injunction for a sannyasi. But in chastising, he was always engaged in chastising, finding fault with somebody, trying to look for faults, searching for faults even if there are none. So that was what Paramananda Puri was pointing out. Don't confuse that with glorification of devotees. Okay, next question. If we don't see our progress, then how can we get encouragement or take pleasure? Of course, you are meant to follow all the rules and regulations for progressing, and you have to understand from other devotees whether you are on the right track, whether you require some correction, whether you require some better understanding, where you have might have some misunderstanding like that. So that is where you actually have to seek out guidance, seek out help. As I said, without associate devotees, it's never possible to properly practice or properly make advancement. Next question. I see that success is usually followed by pride. So how to avoid this and take success pleasure positively? See, success, if it is attributed to oneself, that is when pride comes. Always attribute success to Paramatma. You heard this earlier. Many times you have heard this. Success is always attributed to whom? To Paramatma, to Krishna, Guru and Krishna. So then if there is success, who is to be actually considered as the actual cause or actual person behind the success? It is Guru and Krishna. So then that is the way. So you consider yourself as fortunate, having been blessed by Krishna, Guru and Krishna, to actually be a part of this devotional service where success was achieved. So that is the mercy of the Supreme Lord and the spiritual master. How do I respect a devotee if I don't like him? See, this likes and dislikes towards others is a material conditioning. Please understand this. So as we become free from material conditioning, our likes and dislikes, material likes and dislikes, will get cleansed away. This is actually a necessary step that we have to actually come to. A step to take to become free from all material likes and dislikes. I mean, see, a person we generally see is like his external body or is just his mind, superficial mind. No, we are not meant to see that actually. As devotees, we should see everyone in terms of their spirit or spiritual self. So we don't go by their conditioned behavior or the conditioned conditioned mind, how it reacts under situations, no. So that way we don't have any specific like or dislike for anybody. We respect Vaishnavas according to etiquette. Okay, we will stop here. It's 1 o'clock. Thank you. Hare Krishna.